So our next speaker is Morgan Shook. He will address incentives for infill development, including infrastructure financing and developer incentives. Mr. Shook is a director at Echo Northwest, an economics, finance, and planning firm based in Seattle, Portland, and Boise. Morgan is a strategist and an analyst working in community and economic development. His practice sits at the intersection of real estate development, land use planning, public service delivery, and taxation and infrastructure investment. His expertise in economic, fiscal, market, GIS, and demographic analysis has been applied to financial and policy projects for cities, counties, and ports across the state of Washington. He has worked extensively with local governments, understanding the fiscal impacts of land use to support strategic land use decisions and effective planning for infrastructure funding. Morgan received his MA in Urban and Regional Planning from Portland State's University School of Urban Studies and Planning, and he graduated from the University of Puget Sound with a BS in Molecular Biology. He also has a certificate in Commercial Real Estate Development from the University of Washington and is an AICP member. Please welcome Morgan.
I didn't realize Heather was going to read all that, but I would have shortened it up a little bit. That's one hat I wear. I also wear a hat that's similar to a lot of the folks. I also sit on the City of Seattle's Planning Commission, where I chair the Housing and Neighborhoods Committee. So I have a perspective here on the types of things you guys get. But in my work life, when I'm not giving time to the community, much like you guys are doing, I work a lot with mid-size and small communities who are grappling with these issues, and I'm glad we sequenced it the way we have, because I think following Joe's great talk, a lot of what I'm trying to work on is basically how do we take that vision, how do we take those tools and concepts that spell out that vision and operationalize that vision and implement it. And so I want to talk about a few of the challenges and tools available to local jurisdictions, and how you might want to think about these challenges or this issue, particularly related to infill. I want to plant a couple thoughts in your mind here as we kind of work through the conversation here today. And the first one is to remember our typical sort of default position, how local infrastructure is funded and financed, and it's all project-specific basis, mostly through our development impact mitigation that's allowed through the police powers of government. So when there's a nexus and rep proportionality and those tests are met, a project goes forward and says, well, you have to improve the right-of-way here, you have to improve the frontage, you have to make these improvements to the utility system and the roads. And so typically for infill, that's our main tool to go forward. On the flip side, our main tool in help supporting infill development is a range of incentives, particularly financial, permitting, and other types of softer incentives that help sort of move projects forward. And the way you tie those two pieces together is the more you can incent what you want, the more you're able also to leverage a lot of the infrastructure investment. So just wanted to couple those two ideas together. Just to leave a third thought in, when you put funding of infrastructure as part of the incentive, you now have a public-private partnership, which we won't be talking about today. Okay, so infill development in sort of suburban and small communities faces basically two big challenges, and these things are not exclusive, and there's probably more, but I'll just kind of highlight the first one. The first one is really around the development economics situation. And so as Thera highlighted before, you know, you're not typically thinking about a greenfield site. Sometimes there's vacant properties that are underutilized. Sometimes there are properties with existing uses on them. And so how a developer approaches that situation is very different. The second thing, and I think as if you looked a lot at those images that Joe put forward, you saw a lot of great infrastructure. And I think something that bigger cities, Seattle, Bellevue, and some of the cities that Joe highlighted there, it's not cheap to recreate the physical ecosystem that is necessary to support the types of higher levels of human activity, so residential, living, employees. And so it takes a lot of money to do that. And so for smaller cities, the combination of these two things comes to a head. So I want to just basically kind of have everyone put their sort of developer hat on real quick. And if I leave you with one idea here in terms of how you think about this going forward, is take a look at what the assessor puts out and take a look at the valuation of places, and it's always not perfect given how the assessor does these things, but look at the value of the land, because the value of the land tells you a lot about what the local circumstances are. And so what I mean by that, employment, jobs, the demand for housing, the demand for office, all those things, and the impact of infrastructure, improving the roads, creating great spaces, all those things get capitalized into the value of the land. And so as people compete for that scarce resource of really great space, location, 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 that gets bid up. And so the way, you know, this is a real rudimentary way, but it's a good way to think about it. So what I have up here is basically a hypothetical multifamily project that's worth about $3.2 million. And so if I'm a developer, I'm saying, okay, I'm taking a look at some places in Tumwater. I've done a little market research. I kind of know what the rents look like. You know, oh, they're getting about $14 a square foot for office rents here or something like that. And I say, okay, well, if I built something that looked like what the regulations said I could build, and I was able to sort of generate income and net out my operating expenses, what would it be worth? And then I say, okay, well, I still have to get some money together, invest in the project. That's a cost to it as well. And then I have to build it. And so what I say is basically, if I put those two things together, I can calculate what I think the land is worth. And this is typically called a residual land value analysis. And so hypothetically in this project, if I put those pieces together, I say, okay, well, I think this project, if looking at what the total income is net of it, I think it's worth about $3.2 million. What is it going to cost to build me? So this is basically your soft and hard costs, so design, engineering, permitting, and actually building the actual structure. What's left is basically what I would be willing to pay for land. And so if I think that land is roughly worth $1 million, if I believe my sort of analysis here, and I can get that land for, say, $500,000, I'm doing that deal because all of a sudden, you know, I was able to make $500,000 on arbitrage on the land. If that land was available, say, for $2 million, this project doesn't work, so I need to rethink it, or maybe just not feasible. So why this matters, particularly for infill development, is that typically you're looking at a variety of different redevelopment hurdles. And so on one end, you could have vacant land that's probably not worth a whole lot, but typically is in a lot of the suburban and existing communities, as we kind of look at the inner core of them, they already have a lot of uses on them. And some of them are particularly low densities, but some of them may be buildings and otherwise. So you have what we call kind of a different kind of hurdle rate in order to say, does this project pencil? So just for giggles here, so here's a project that I, you know, just say, okay, well, if I did some analysis, say I'm looking at sort of a higher mixed-use project that's got residential, office, you know, retail, whole smash, I think I could do this. And I think the land is worth X amount. And I'm looking at a site in the city that says a parking lot. Well, I think the land's worth this much. I can get the land for this. I'm doing this project. Check, that pencils. Okay, well, let's think about, like, here's another higher intensity use, like it's a strip mall, you know, and or a hip mall, and as there was I coined a term, I hadn't heard that actually, but say, oh, like that, it's a little bit worth, the land's worth a little bit more, but hey, I still think my project is worth more, so that pencils. But hey, here's a real intense use, and particularly a commercial use, because they'll always typically outbid a lot of residential uses in infill development, but you know, that land is worth a lot more, so I'm not doing that project, it doesn't pencil. So in reality, particularly for a lot of suburban and smaller cities, this hurdle rate sometimes is right here, that the land is simply not worth that much, given what I think I could rent it for to somebody, so somebody would pay me money, income, to do it. And so that's the fundamental challenge, and depending on where that hurdle rate is, when we think about infrastructure and incentives, is how do I close this value gap? Because what we're looking at is, and we actually, well, one, two things. We're wanting to know how can we close it, but more importantly, we also want to know how big is it? You know, are we talking, you know, millions of dollars? Are we close? Because then that tells you a lot about sort of what you can do. You know, will any incentive really make any, you know, categorical difference in catalyzing a project. Will any piece of infrastructure potentially that we might be able to provide or fund make a qualitative and categorical difference in making the project move forward? So I'll just kind of pivot now to development incentives. And so I'll just start with a real broad definition. So a payment or concession to stimulate greater output or investment. So this is a broad range of things. But when we think about, particularly when cities and planning commissions and other folks start thinking about incentives that the public can offer, particularly for infill, we're going to narrow this down. And basically, can we find ways to close the value gap? And so I want to just talk a little bit about some ways to think about incentives and the types of things that are out there. And so the first thing, I think I'll just kind of divide our incentives into kind of two big categories. And the first one is increased certainty incentives. And because, like as everyone likes to say, time is money. But then there's the second category, which is the financial. And of course, the best thing about that is money is money. And so it's a lot easier to figure out what that is. So I'll start with a little bit on the sort of increased certainty side of incentives. And here, Joe kind of laid out in his first graphic around all that middle piece in terms of once you have your regulatory process set and then you start processing permits, what can you do here to sort of, you know, make a difference? And I tend to think about, I mean, people talk a lot, and there's a lot of focus on permits and streamlining, and I tend to think of these things as good incentives, but more so as just good sort of public service. I mean, I think we all want high quality, we want things to work well, we want to be able to expedite things. This is a core service that we're providing. And so this is an image from a friend of mine who does multifamily development in Seattle, and he was ranting on a Twitter post around the regulatory process, and not to say that those projects wouldn't work otherwise, but it's one of those things. I think the more we can shorten it, particularly for infill development, because what you're fundamentally dealing with on the development side is a much riskier project. And so the more time you stretch out and the more hurdles and process we have to go through, the more the project has to carry some sort of cost, whether it be the land or other kinds of design and permitting costs that on the margins, you know, may affect a project. Maybe it just doesn't happen this time, maybe it happens the next development cycle. The second big category of sort of increased certainty things are things we can do on the SEPA side, and I don't have it spelled out, but the State Environmental Policy Act, Policy Act, yes, that's right. I don't even know what it is. Shortened to SEPA. Hopefully nobody from ecology here, because I borrowed this here not to really explain what it is, but just to say that SEPA has its own sort of design and permitting process that projects have to go through. And so for infill development, and I won't sort of repeat all the great reasons why we should be supporting and why GMA does support infill, because I think Thera did a great job of outlining that. Our great legislatures and our government has basically provided ways to say, well, here's a way for us to incent it by basically reducing some of the regulatory and permitting costs on the SEPA side. And I'm going to talk about kind of two big pieces there. And the first one is called the Planned Action EIS, and the second one are basically some just SEPA exemptions. So what's a planned action here? And so a planned action is basically a way to do streamlined entitlement and permitting. Basically, the process is, and I think if you pick up where Joe left off and said, you know, we start with vision, we start with a sub-area plan, we create regulations, we've done all that work. What SEPA allows you to do in this instance is to actually do a lot of upfront environmental review. So you can study the impacts of that broader vision and what your zoning and regulations have put in place. And so you can spell out what the transportation impacts are, what the impacts are to public services and such, and then define the mitigation that would be necessary. So projects that ultimately would apply for permits in within these areas can actually, if they fall within the things studied in the planned action, can basically streamline their SEPA process. And also at the same time, it narrows basically the public process for appeals as well. So it helps give projects that fall within that area a little more certainty around, you know, well, you've already said this is the vision. I've got a project that meets your vision and your regulations. Let's kind of move this through fairly quickly. The second big category are sort of SEPA categorical exemptions. And so through your CEPA rules in your city code, cities have discretion around exempting projects that fall below a minimum threshold. And here, typically, at most cities are at basically 4 dwelling units per acre. Sorry. Yes, thank you. But you also have, but depending on how big you are and what kind of city you are, you also have a little more wider discretion on raising that minimum threshold. And so basically, if you're a project that applies and falls within those things, that project can be exempt from CEPA review. There's also CEPA infill exemptions. And so this is one that's really relevant to a lot of the cities here as well, because what you have to do is basically kind of checklist kind of thing. You know, am I sort of, you know, within a UGA? Am I, basically, have I identified the need for increased densities within my urban areas? And did I do a programmatic EIS as part of my comprehensive plan update or sub-area plan that put those regulations in place? If that's the case, you can provide certain projects that meet those criteria's exemption from CEPA. All right, so financial incentives here. And so this is a very interesting area, because lots of cities get creative around what they mean by financial, how they get potentially money to projects and support those things going forward. But generally, the Washington State Constitution really limits what local jurisdictions can do in terms of providing public funding, private public dollars for private enterprise. And this is it's a different limitation than as is practiced in many other parts of the country. And we don't have some of the other sort of roundabout sort of public development authorities and other things that a lot of places have that actually sort of circumvent that by allowing public dollars to get into those projects. And so for cities, what we mostly see is basically financial incentives that are delivered through the tax, basically, or tax policy, or what we call tax expenditures. And so the biggest one, and actually a very powerful one, potentially, is actually the multifamily property tax exemption. And so what the shorthand MFTE program allows cities to do is to create a property tax abatement. So basically, qualifying projects that apply can be exempt from the residential portion of the improvement from paying property taxes. And not just city property taxes, but property taxes for every jurisdiction that project falls within. There are two flavors of the program. There is an 8-year program and a 12-year program in terms of the length of the abatement. The 12-year program requires some affordable housing provisions be met that are spelled out in state law, but typically they fall within kind of the 60 AMI and above range. The 8-year program actually has a little more wider discretion in terms of the strings that the city may choose to attach, and a lot of cities in more suburban or emerging downtowns have actually kind of ratcheted back and say, well, we just want you to do, you know, higher density residential, so we're going to put a sort of yield piece on it, or we want a certain value, so we want all your units actually to be worth $200,000 or more or something like that. And so the value of the incentive, particularly as like related to that first definition I threw up there, how do you get more output, is really where you might target this, because ultimately what it does, that, you know, if for projects that are residential, that value potentially can get capitalized back in the land. And so when we looked at this in a lot of different places, in Seattle and some of the suburban areas, the MFTE program can make about 5 to 7 points in terms of project on project yield. So actually not a bad incentive. So the great thing about this is the city can unilaterally do it. And so it doesn't need a partnership with the county, the school district, or the state in order to move this thing forward. Like I said before, it's just on the residential portion. So if the project has a commercial or retail portion, that part still pays property tax. And the sort of best part about this, I mean, depending, or best or worst part about this, depending on your perspective, is that it typically doesn't cost the city any lost revenue. And this is mostly a quirk of our property tax system that limits levy collections as opposed to levy yields on individual projects. So what happens is basically everyone else pays a little bit more to offset the cost of the incentive. fee waivers. So there's another way that money can get moved around. And so the first one, I think a lot, some cities do, are around sort of waiving permit fees for certain types of projects. Permit fees as a total cost of the project aren't huge, but, you know, they provide a little additional lift. And a lot of cities have a lot of wide latitude on what projects and which ones and how much they give on the exemption. The challenge on the basically for cities on the financial side, because most planning and current planning and permit review is really run on a cost recovery basis. And so any project not paying permit dollars to pay for somebody to review the permit, that money needs to be made up somewhere else. Impact fees are a whether through concurrency or through transport or benefit districts are a great way to sort of fund infrastructure, and because it's a project specific source tied to the development, but also they can also tend to be a pretty large portion of the project's costs. And so some cities have chosen to be creative around sort of waiving the impact fee. But here there's some places that you need to be careful about. The first one is that basically you can only really sort of exempt or reduce the impact fee for broad public purposes. And so that's been mostly construed in basically supporting affordable housing. So a lot of cities in the Puget Sound region have waived impact fees for their affordable housing projects. Other projects that may be a little more public purpose or have elements of public purpose may also choose to sort of waive these sort of fees as well, but that's less common. Other cities have gotten really creative and basically tied together tax increment finance with the waiving of the fees, because what happens if you basically don't collect the fee, you still have a gap that needs to be made up, so you have to find a way and not have everyone pay more, so it usually means putting more general fund dollars to make some of that offset up. Okay, so I just wanted to highlight what I thought are some just kind of relevant tools to be thinking about on the regulatory side as well as the incentive side. And so now I want to just basically turn to the second piece here, is on sort of how to support infill development. What we know is a lot of these places in inner city either has really old stuff or it's really inadequate. You know, so initially when things were built out, how many ever years ago, we didn't have a lot of the same sort of infrastructure and design standards around what the right-of-way needed to be improved to, and you know, it was very much more geared towards a low-density development pattern. And so what a lot of cities are finding themselves have to do, either they have big parcels that just need more infrastructure like local roads and parks and other things, and so there's just a lot of new stuff that needs to get in. Or even in places where you have existing infrastructure, we now want a higher quality and need a higher quality of infrastructure to support the activity that we're envisioning. And so just a couple pieces of nomenclature to get straight, because people always kind of confuse these two things, that funding and finance are really different things. Okay. So on the funding side, it's basically, where does the money come from? You know, how would you, you know, fund something? Like I'm buying a house, is I think is a good analogy. I'm going to fund that out of my wages. How might I finance that? I could either pay as I go, or I might issue debt, like a mortgage. And so financing never increases the amount of money that you have available, because we're always having to pay interest on that, whatever that debt may be. And so that's just mostly a pet peeve I wanted to bring forward. My small petty battle that I'm bad. So I think infrastructure funding is really, really hard, particularly for any jurisdiction, but particularly for smaller jurisdictions. And I'll kind of get to why that's the case. So I'm going to show you a bunch of different charts here that were pulled out of a Congressional Budget Office study that was done back in 2009, looking at the state of infrastructure funding in totality, so federal, state, and local dollars that are all sort of geared towards it. And so the big thing here for all these things, particularly for transportation and water, but water infrastructure here just means water and sewer, we're just spending a lot less money, particularly as the size of our economy. We're paying a little bit more, but as a share of what we need, that has been declining. And now this chart ends in 2007, and it doesn't look any better in the next 7 years. It's also costing us a whole lot more to build infrastructure. And so what we've got here is the FHWA's Highway Construction Price Index over time. And I won't get into all the reasons of why this is much more expensive, but you know, we got a lot more things we need to be paying attention to that sort of Joe and Thera outlined. And so it's just much harder to do projects on a per unit basis than it was back in 1956. And you know what? Of that money that we're spending on infrastructure, there are two pieces of that. You know, there's new stuff we're building, new capital stuff. But increasingly on local and state budgets, operations are becoming an increasingly large share of making things work. We're trying to get more out of what we already have, and it's costing us a lot more to do it on a per unit basis than it has in the past. And so, this is all bad news. So, where has it all been going? Our big challenge is that locals have been increasingly responsible for paying for infrastructure. And this is a real challenging problem because ways we fund things, particularly at the state and local levels, are particularly regressive on low and middle income families. And as we've seen in a lot of sort of infrastructure votes going forward, the tax burdens are becoming really high and people are just saying like, we can't stomach this, even though we think it's a really good purpose. As opposed to the federal level, which have much more progressive taxation through income taxes, that piece has stayed relatively flat over the last 20 years and actually is declining. And if anybody's been paying attention to the news, you probably heard that the Highway Trust Fund account is actually going to run out of money in August, but I'm sure they'll do something at the last second. So funding strategies. So how do you sort of put money into these things? And so there, you know, particularly money that isn't on the private side, as I kind of talked about as part of the development mitigation process. And basically they're, you know, on the, as those charts show, there's just fewer federal and state dollars for capital purposes going forward. We have a bunch of competitive processes that are awarded through our sort of transportation planning organizations. Those dollars are getting scarcer. They're getting much more competitive. They have award caps, and so they're really tough to get. And so for infill development, what's really going to be key in terms of creating the juice to support the physical side of things, those local dollars, finding ways to secure, raise, and administer dollars will largely determine your success in doing this because, one, you need it, and two, almost all these programs where you're looking for money from somebody else require local match dollars. So generally, when we think about these strategies, right, we've got basically project mitigation approaches, so project-specific approaches, and we've got, you know, basically more sort of non-project-specific approaches, basically just sort of general dollars that we can pay for parks, transportation, or other types of infrastructure needs. So most of the stuff that happens at the development mitigation side are all project-specific things. Things that happen at the federal and state piece through competitive awards processes are also tend to be more project-specific. Things at the local level, you actually have a lot more latitude in terms of what types of things you want to spend that money on. And so for cities, it's really taking, say, we already have these tools to pay for capital, things like REIT and impact fees. And so basically, are there ways for us to expand the capacity to do that? On the second side, we've got a bunch of choices for cities to contemplate. How do we get potentially more money into funding the needs that we have identified? And so basically, you can expand, you can think about dedicating certain portions of non-capital dollars. So a lot of some cities say, well, we'll take a little bit of our general fund dollars from sales tax and we're going to put it in an infrastructure fund or something like that. Or we're going to raise our utility taxes and dedicate that as a new funding stream to pay for capital. And then the last piece is basically pursuing new tools. And in Washington, unfortunately, the new tools aren't all that robust. And I'm just going to highlight a few. And the first one is basically a series of tools related to what they call value capture, most personified in Washington and as tax increment financing. And so cities basically do a lot of this either formally. There's several tools that are available right now. None of them that have the needed lift, and I'll kind of get to that. But here's where a lot of cities get creative with more informal versions of tax increment finance. We have a project. Perhaps they need some incentive to help fund infrastructure, or maybe they need some regulatory relief on something. What might be the value of the stream of tax benefits that might flow over that project, and would we like to take some of that and plow it into the project today? That's the basic idea. And so in Washington, we've got several sort of tools here, like, you know, the ones that are active I would highlight is community revitalization financing, all these great projects, LIFT, LRF, that were funded by the state over the last decade were fantastic, but there's no state commitment to fund those projects or fund those programs anymore. So lobby your legislator for more local tools there. So here you're really talking about potentially trying to find partnerships with mostly your county or your port district if they'd be willing to sacrifice a portion of their incremental property taxes to pay for infrastructure. Other sort of forms of value capture tools are things like LIDs. Basically, they're saying if we make this investment, that investment gets capitalized into the land. You, property owner, potentially, would you be willing to pay a little bit of an assessment to help fund that piece? LIDs are very challenging and because they basically take a village in order to move forward. An untested tool is community facility districts, where basically think about it as a kind of LID on steroids. You can pay for a lot more different types of things, but the circumstances of which they might be workable particularly relate to a lot of big sub-area development where you have a lot of single owner pieces because you're going to need a lot of that village to kind of move it forward. The last piece I'll highlight, and I think a lot of cities in Washington have moved this way just to solve the transportation funding challenges, whether they be on the capital side or on the operation side or transportation benefit districts. And here, there are a lot of different ways you could put together a program, a district here, but basically you could have it on a sub-area wide, you can have it on a city-wide, depending on the geography that you choose. Certain funding tools will be available to you, so sales taxes, property taxes, impact fees, vehicle license fees, and depending on those, the permutation of those two pieces, you could either move forward on a councilmatic way, so the council could create it, or you'll have to go to the voters. So, I'm going to tie that up and basically leave, I think, a positive message here that if you think about the challenge that you have, particularly related to what it is you're trying to achieve, what the current situation looks like on the development feasibility side, and thinking about the myriad of tools that you could potentially put together on either the supporting the project specifically through incentives or through infrastructure can go a long way to help implement a lot of these projects.